Absolute Surrender, The Blessedness of Forsaking All and Following Christ, by the Reverend Andrew Murray, narrated by Mark Bowen. Chapter 1. Be Filled with the Holy Spirit. The following words from Scripture are probably familiar to most Christians. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. Acts chapter 2, verse 4. And be filled with the Spirit. Ephesians chapter 5, verse 18. The first text is a narrative. It tells us what actually happened. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit. The other text is a command. It tells us what we ought to do. Be filled with the Spirit. In case there might be any doubt in our minds about whether or not it is actually a command to be filled with the Spirit, we find it linked to another command. Be not drunk with wine, but be filled with the Spirit. If I ask if you obey the command to not be drunk with wine, you would probably answer at once, "Of course, as a Christian, I obey that command." But have you obeyed the other command, to be filled with the Spirit? Is that the life you are living? If not, why not? Are you willing to take up that command today? Will you say, "By God's help, I am going to obey. I will not give myself any rest until I have obeyed that command, until I am filled with the Spirit"? I want to say at the very beginning that this is a simple question of listening to a command of God's Holy Spirit from His Word. We do not want to have a theological discussion here about all that could be said about the filling of the Holy Spirit, because that may lead you away into ideas and thoughts that are really of no value in helping us reach our purpose. Instead, we want to begin at once by saying that God has this message for every Christian. My child, I want you to be filled with the Spirit. Let your answer be, "Father, I want it too. I am ready. I yield myself to obey you. Let me be filled with your Spirit." To prevent wrong impressions of what it means to be filled with the Spirit, let me just say that it does not mean a state of high excitement, a state of absolute perfection, or a state in which there will be no growth. No. Being filled with the Spirit is simply this: having my whole nature yielded to His power. When the whole soul is yielded to the Holy Spirit, God Himself will fill it. Search me, O God. Now the question I want to ask is, what is needed in order to be filled with the Spirit? The question is of the utmost importance, and if we try to find the answers that must be given, we will need to search ourselves. Frank Bottom wrote a hymn called "Search Me, O God, My Actions Try," which has words that are relevant to our topic. Search me, O God, my actions try, and let my life appear, as seen by thine all-searching eye, to mine my ways make clear. Search all my sense and know my heart, who only canst make known, and let the deep, the hidden part, to me be fully shown. Throw light into the darkened cells, where passion reigns within. Quicken my conscience till it feels the loathsomeness of sin. Search all my thoughts, the secret springs, the motives that control, the chambers where polluted things hold empire o'er the soul. Search till your fiery glance hast cast its holy light through all, and I by grace am brought at last before your face to fall. Thus prostrate I shall learn of thee what now I feebly prove, that God alone in Christ can be unutterable love. David prayed, "Search me, O God, and know my heart. Psalm 139, verse 23. That verse and the hymn above are prayers asking God to search us. We do not usually see our hearts as God sees them, so we need God to search us. As God searches our hearts, we need to pay attention and notice the results. This will help us look into our hearts and lives and ask, "Am I ready and open so God can fill me with the Spirit?" I think the answers we find may also help to encourage us. Some people may be honestly ready for God to search them. They might thank God, and they might even see that they are kept back from this full blessing simply by some ignorance or prejudice or unbelief or wrong thoughts of what the blessing is. We can best find the answer to our question by looking at the way in which Christ prepared the disciples for the day of Pentecost. In some countries, when a missionary preaches and leads people to Jesus, the missionary forms a class for these new Christians to teach them God's word, make them disciples, and prepare them for baptism. He may keep some of these young converts in the baptismal class for a year or longer to educate, train, and test them, to prepare them for the Christian life. In the early church were similar groups of new converts called catechumens, who were instructed in the principles of the Christian faith and observed for a while to be sure their lives were consistent with those who were followers of Jesus. Jesus taught his disciples for 3 years. He trained and prepared them throughout that time. It was not a magic thing or an arbitrary thing when the Holy Spirit came down upon them. They were prepared for it. John the Baptist told them what was to come. He not only preached the Lamb of God who was to shed his blood, but he told us that it was by special revelation from God that he, on whom he saw the Holy Spirit descend, would baptize with the Holy Spirit. Of what did the training of those disciples consist? How were they prepared for the baptism of the Holy Spirit? Forsake all. I ask you to remember that the disciples were men who had forsaken all to follow Jesus. The Lord Jesus went to a fisherman and said, "Leave your net behind and follow me." To another man he said, "Leave your position as a tax collector and come and follow me." They did it. They left those things behind and followed Jesus. They would later say, by the mouth of Peter, "We have forsaken all and followed thee." Matthew chapter 9, verse 27. They left their homes, their families, and their good names. Men mocked and laughed at them. Men called them the disciples of Jesus, and when he was despised and hated, they were hated too. They identified themselves with him and gave themselves up entirely to follow him. This is the first step to being filled with the Holy Spirit. We must forsake all to follow Christ. I am not speaking about forsaking sin, though you ought to do that when you are converted. Forsaking all is something that has a far wider meaning. Many Christians think of Jesus as someone who can save them and help them, but they practically deny him as master. They think they have a right to have their own will in 1,000 things. They speak however they like, do whatever they want to do, and use their property and possessions however they choose. They are pleased with themselves and their lives, and they never stop to consider that they might not have forsaken all for Jesus. They are their own masters, and they have never dreamed of saying, "Jesus, I forsake all to follow you." Yet this is the demand of Christ. Jesus has such infinite riches and glory that he deserves it, and he is such a heavenly, spiritual, divine gift that unless we give up everything, our hearts cannot be filled with him. So Jesus comes and says, "Forsake all and follow me." I was once at Johannesburg, South Africa, at a convention. Let me share just one simple story of what has been done there in God's kingdom. I held some services, and on an afternoon, when there was a gathering of believers testifying of what God had done for them, one poor woman rose and told how 6 months before she had received a wonderful blessing through the inflowing of God's Spirit. At a consecration meeting, which she had attended in a very poor neighborhood, the minister who gave an address asked if any were ready to give themselves up entirely for Jesus. He used the words, "Suppose he wanted you to go to China, or to give up your wife and children, would you be willing to do it?" The woman said earnestly, "I did want to say that I would give up everything to Jesus, but I could not. When he asked those to rise who were willing, I was in a great state of turmoil, but I could not remain sitting. I rose and said, 'Yes, I will give up everything. Yet I feel as if I could not give up my husband and children. I went home, but I could not sleep. I could not rest, for there was the struggle. Must I give up everything? I wanted to do it for the sake of Jesus. It was past midnight, and I said, "Lord, yes, for you, everything." And the joy and the power of the Spirit flowed into my heart. She testified, and her minister testified of her too, that she walked in the joy of the Lord. Dear friends, maybe you have never sincerely said it because you never thought it was needed, but say it now if you mean it. O Christ, let me be filled with the Holy Spirit. I will give up anything and everything, except my surrender of all to you. Each of us must examine himself. Some of us may have never thought that this was a necessity. Some have never understood what it meant when Jesus said, "If anyone comes to me and does not hate his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, and even his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. Any one of you that does not forsake all that he has cannot be my disciple." Luke chapter 14, verse 26 and 33. Isn't this the reason for our feeble spiritual lives, and the reason that the Holy Spirit does not fill us? We have never forsaken all to follow Christ. Fellowship with Jesus. Not only were they men who had forsaken all to follow Jesus, but they were also intensely attached to him. Jesus said, "If ye love me, keep my commandments. I will ask the Father, and he shall give you another comforter." John chapter 14, verses 15 to 16. They did love him intensely. They had seen him crucified, but their hearts could not be separated from him. They had no hope or joy or comfort on earth without him. And friends, this is what is so often lacking in our Christianity. We trust Jesus and his work on Calvary. We trust him as our only Savior. That is well and may be sufficient to bring salvation, but many do not realize that true Christianity consists in an intense, close, personal attachment to Jesus and fellowship with him every day. Many think of Jesus as their Savior, yet never realize that Jesus ought to be their friend and guide and keeper all day long, their leader and master, whom they gladly obey. Many Christians might talk about him, yet not know what it means to walk with him. One of the strong elements of Keswick teaching is this intimate walk with Jesus. 2 or 3 years ago, a young lady missionary came to South Africa, and she spoke about the blessings she had received at Keswick. She told me how, from a child, she had loved the Lord Jesus, had been educated in a circle of godly friends, and was raised in a godly home. But what a difference it made to her when she found what it is to receive the deeper blessing. I said to her, "From your childhood you have lived in a happy, godly atmosphere. Tell me what you think is the difference between the life you lived then and the life you enjoyed afterwards." Her answer was simple and ready and cheerful. "It is just this," she said. "It is the personal fellowship with Jesus." Oh, friends, we must have such a beginning. Some people would forsake everything for the sake of their religion. For a false religion, multitudes have given up all. Some people would forsake all for the sake of their church. Some people would forsake all for the sake of their fellow citizens. This is not what is needed, though. We need to forsake all for the sake of Jesus. We need to let Him come into our lives and take possession of our hearts. Do we have a life of tender personal attachment to Jesus and joy in Him? I do not ask if you have perfectly achieved this, but I do wonder if we can honestly say, "It is what I am striving after. It is my main desire and goal. It is what I long for above everything else. Jesus Christ must have my heart and my will every moment of every day." Self. These disciples of Jesus were men who had been led to despair of themselves. At the beginning of their 3 years of instruction, they had to give up everything they possessed. But only at the end of that time could they begin to give up themselves. They had given up their nets and their homes and their friends, and that was right and good to do. But their self-will, and their self-desire remained strong all 3 years. Jesus had often spoken to them about humility, but they did not understand Him. Time after time, contention arose among them as to who should be the greatest. At the table at the Last Supper, they were still talking about who would be first among them. They had not given up self. As was made plain more than once, they struggled to live in the spirit of Jesus. However, Christ taught them and trained them. He revealed to them time after time what the sin of pride is and what the glory of humility is. When He died upon the cross, they died a terrible death too. Think of Peter, the impulsive, hasty disciple who denied his Lord. Do you not think that in all the sorrows of those 3 days, from the crucifixion day to the resurrection day, Peter's deepest and bitterest sorrow was this, the shame at the thought of how he had treated his Lord? Then he learned to despair of himself. At the Last Supper, how self-confident he had been. "Though all men shall be offended in thee, yet I will never be offended." Matthew chapter 26, verse 33. But Jesus took Peter's self-will down with Him into death and the grave, and then Peter realized that there was in him indeed no good thing. He had learned to despair of himself. Some may say, "I think I have given up all for Jesus, my property, my home, my friends, my position, and I think I do love Him, but somehow things are not right. I still am not near Jesus. I still lack holiness and His love and power." Dear friends, are you willing that God, with His searchlight, should reveal to you how much self-will and self-trust is in you? Take, for instance, your judgment of people. You say whatever you like and whatever you think, and even boast that you say whatever is on your mind, yet you have not yet learned to study the humility and tenderness and gentleness of Jesus. You say what you think, even though you might not always think before you say it. That is self. You work for Him, You try to do good, but all the time you are doing your own work. You as a Christian are doing the work, and you look to God to help and bless. But that cannot be. God must first bring each one of us down into the place of death. Do you know what the death of Jesus means? It means that Jesus said to his Father, in effect, "Here is my life so precious to me, my life which has been sinless. I have yielded it to you in life, but now I am going to yield it to you in death." Jesus went into the grave saying, "Into thy hands I commend, I give away, I entrust my spirit." Luke chapter 23, verse 46. You know what happened. Because he gave up his life so entirely and sank into the thick darkness of death and the grave, God raised him up into a new life and a new glory and a new power. God raised him from the grave to glory. Death was the secret of the resurrection. If you want to be filled with the Spirit and the risen life of glory, you must first die to self. The apostles were men who had been brought to utter self-despair. They were men who had lost all and were ready to receive all from God in heaven. God's promise. These apostles were men who had accepted the promise of the Spirit from Jesus in faith. On that last night, Christ had spoken to them about the Holy Spirit more than once, and when he was ready to ascend, he said again, "Ye shall be baptized in the Holy Spirit not many days from now." Acts chapter 1, verse 5. If you had asked those disciples what that meant, I am sure they could not have told you. They did not understand it, perhaps, as much as we do now. They had no concept of what would come, but they took the word of Jesus. And if they had any need for talking or arguing during those 10 days, I am sure they said, "If while he was on earth, he did such wonderful things for us, now that he is in glory, he will do things infinitely more wonderful." And they waited for that. I want you to accept this promise by faith and say, "That promise of the filling of the Holy Spirit is for me. I accept it at the hand of Jesus." You may not understand it. You may not feel as you would like to feel. You may feel yourself weak and sinful and far away from Jesus. But you may come today and say, "That promise is for me." Are you ready to do so? Are you ready in faith to trust the promise and the word and the love of Jesus? I am sure many believers struggle to find out what they are lacking and what is missing. They might have given themselves up most heartily and fully to Jesus. They love him, and they have sought to humble themselves in the dust. What is missing is simply that they have not learned to say, "He has promised and he will do it." Let me say, for your encouragement, that a promise from God is worth just as much as a fulfillment. A promise brings you into direct contact with God, so honor him by trusting the promise and obeying him. If there is any preparation that you still need, God knows about it. If there is anything that is to be opened up to you, he will do it, if you depend on him to do it. Trust the promise and say, "This fullness of the Holy Spirit is for me." Wait in prayer. On the strength of that promise, the disciples waited in united prayer. Wait on God in prayer. They waited and they prayed with one accord. Prayer and supplication went up to God, mingled with praise. They expected God in heaven to do something. I wish I could tell you the importance of that. I find Christians, and I have found it in my own experience, who read, understand, think, and wish. They want to claim, want to take, and want to get, and yet what they crave eludes their grasp. Why? Because they do not wait for God to give it. Don't look to what we say or what you think and understand with a view of getting a blessing out of it. Look to God and expect God to do something. It is not enough to believe. I find that many people mistake faith for the blessing that faith is intended to bring. By faith, I am to inherit the promises. Oh, believe and trust God, then look to Him to give the blessing. Be filled with the Holy Spirit. Chapter 2. Changed by the Spirit of God. I want to tell you what the blessedness is of a life filled with the Holy Spirit. It may please God to make our desire so strong and make us see so clearly that He may bring us to receive more than we ever expected. We need to get to the point where we say, "This is just what I need. I cannot live any longer without it." Our God is willing and able to do above what we ask or think. Ephesians chapter 3, verse 20. I cannot put the blessedness of being filled with the Spirit more clearly before you than by simply pointing out to the wonderful change that Pentecost made in the lives of the disciples. That is one of the most wonderful object lessons in all of Scripture. Those 12 men, under Christ's training for 3 years, yet apparently remaining far from the life they should have been living, then, all at once, by the blessed filling of the Holy Spirit, being made just what God wanted them to be, changed from the inside out. Look first at the change that Pentecost wrought in the disciples' relationship to Jesus. During His life on earth with them, He could not live within them. He was on the outside, separated from them, very near and very loving, but they did not really understand Christ's teaching until the Holy Spirit came. Christ often taught them about humility. He said, "Learn of Me, for I am meek and humble of heart." Matthew chapter 11, verse 29. He said time after time, "He that humbles himself shall be exalted." Luke chapter 14, verse 11. Yet at the Holy Communion table at the Last Supper, there they were, still contending which of them should be the greatest. Christ did not conquer their pride, but not for the lack of divine teaching. Why was it then? It was because of one thing. Christ was still outside of them, and He could not get into their hearts to dwell there. It was impossible. The time had not come, and on earth they had the divine, almighty, blessed Redeemer along with them, but still outside. How different they were from Him! From this we learn that no outward instruction, even from Christ Himself or His words in Holy Scripture, can bring us the true and full blessing until the Holy Spirit works it in us. What a change took place on the day of Pentecost! At that day ye shall know that I am in My Father, and ye in Me, and I in you. John chapter 14, verse 20. What does that mean? Christ in us just the same as we are in a church building? No, we are in the building, but we can go out of it again. I live in a house, but I can leave that house and go elsewhere. The church building and the house and I are not vitally, organically connected. But the Lord Jesus came to be part of those disciples and fill their hearts and thoughts and affections. What Peter and James and John had when they had Christ alongside of them, you and I have, in a much larger measure, if we have the living Christ within us. How did that change come? By the Holy Spirit. At that day, when the Spirit comes, ye shall know that I am in my Father, and ye in me, and I in you. And my Father will love him, and we will come unto him and dwell with him. John chapter 14, verses 20 and 23. Doesn't your heart long for this? I have thought and thought and thought of Jesus in Bethlehem, on Calvary, and upon the throne, and I have worshipped and loved and rejoiced exceedingly in him. But all the time I wanted something better, and something deeper, and something nearer. Don't you want to have the living Jesus within you? That is what the Holy Spirit will give you, and that is why I plead with you now. Won't you give yourselves up for this blessing, to be filled with the Spirit, that the blessed Jesus may be able to take possession of you? Isn't that what your heart longs for? Jesus within, the very Jesus who is the Almighty One, who died on the cross, sits upon the throne, and is willing to dwell in us and be our life. That is why the Spirit comes. Jesus said, "He shall take of that which is mine and shall cause you to know it." John chapter 16, verse 14. What is the glory of Jesus? His love and his power. The Holy Spirit will reveal Christ in us, so that the wonderful love of Christ will be a possession and a reality in its divine nearness, and the power of Christ shall have the victory within us. You know that wonderful prayer in Ephesians 3, that the Father might strengthen them with might by the Spirit in the inner man, and Christ might dwell in their hearts. The mighty power of the Holy Spirit can do it. The Holy Spirit makes Jesus present with us. Unbroken fellowship. The second thought in connection with the change made in the disciples is that not only was Jesus outside of them, but Jesus was not always with them. They could not be with him every moment. At one time he sent them across the sea, and he stayed on the mountain to pray. At another time, he took three of them with him up into the mountain, while the others stayed down below. They had to meet the scribes when they could not cast out the evil spirit. There came times of separation, and at last there came that terrible death, that awful separation from them in this world. Yes, Christ was their life. But they were sometimes with Christ and sometimes not with him. They were sometimes near him, and sometimes they could not get near him because of the crowd around him. Friends, the presence of Jesus by the Holy Spirit is meant to be unbroken, continual, and forever. Isn't that what your heart longs for? Don't you know what it is like to live a week or a month with joy that makes your heart sing all day long? Then the change comes, and the cloud and the darkness come, and you do not know why it is. Sometimes it is because of bodily sickness or depression, sometimes with the cares and the difficulties of this life, or sometimes with the consciousness of your own failure. O child of God, I wish I could tell it to you and see it all clearly myself. Jesus does love you. He does not wish to be separated from you one minute. We want to believe in the love of Jesus. No mother ever delighted in the baby in her arms as much as Jesus delights in you. He wants to be near you and to have unceasing fellowship with you. Take that in, beloved believer, and say, if that is possible, God helping me, I must have this filling of the Holy Spirit, so I may always have Jesus dwelling in my heart. What a difference! Another thought. Look at the change it made in their own inner lives. Up until Pentecost, they lived lives of failure and weakness. I have spoken of their pride. Christ often had to reprove them for their pride. They long to be faithful to him, and yet their pride and their self-confidence was the cause of continual failure. Peter said to him, Though I should die with thee, yet will I not deny thee. And all the others said the same, yet within a few hours they did it, as the result of pride and self-confidence. Matthew chapter 26, verses 35 and 70. They did not know the evil of their own nature. Jesus had done everything to teach them humility.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.